name's Julia.
I'm Dan.
I'm Connor.
Garrett.
Yana.
And we did our project on social media's negative effect on adolescents. Before I do start, I just wanted to let you know there are some slides that are towards probably an older age group, probably around our age. And the reason we included that is because every adolescent ends up growing up and they all need to know what's important in using social media. So first, what is social media? It gives adolescents the ability to join social networking sites to communicate and express themselves. They can speak with family, friends, and participate with people throughout the world, even if they don't know them. Just a few popular social media sites that we use are Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, Pinterest, YouTube, and LinkedIn isn't as much of a social media site, but you still communicate with people and you interact with people. It's kind of one of those that aren't as lenient and dangerous to look out for because it's something everyone should use and it's a good way to create a relationship with other people. However, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat, they all have a way that you can message someone privately or you can post on their site for other people to see them. So you're still interacting with others. The problem with this is social media negatively changed the means of communication amongst adolescents. Teens are missing the opportunities to communicate effectively. They're not in touch with the social cues due to too much technology. They're not seeing how people are interacting back towards them when they say things, which is something we also spoke about in class. And in the picture, it just shows the evolution of communication, how in 1807, it was just a bird bringing a letter to someone else. And then 1982 was one of the bigger phones. And then in 2012, it's a cell phone with Twitter. So I thought it was kind of funny because it does, it's pretty accurate. If uninterrupted, youth will lack the knowledge of how to communicate and interact with everyone around them, whether it's peers, colleagues, potential employers, and family. And in this picture, it just shows how they're all at the dinner table and everyone's on their technology. Everyone's either using an iPad or a phone, and the mom just comes over to serve dinner and they're all using their technology, which is kind of what it's become. Even in restaurants, you see people, they're on their phones. It's normally younger people, but older people are definitely at fault for it too. And next, I will give it to Garrett and he'll just let you know of the possible solutions.
So we have raising awareness overall of just the possible negative effects there are. Maybe make an informational brochure for elementary and middle school parents. Help them have their kids adapt to social media, help reduce the dependence on social media, and creating private and public profiles. So the first one, parents limiting children's time spent on social media. So with a raise of hands, how many of us have any form of social media? Just about all of us. So a study found 73% of teens use some form of it. Obviously all of us have used this, we grew up with it, we adapted with it. Teens using social media were found to be less content overall, which also led to cyberbullying, causing high levels of suicide, depression, and anxiety. Next slide. All right, so here we're going to talk more about us as students. More distractions. We're all capable of being less successful in the classroom and the real world. I mean, I see so many people at work, you know, take out their cell phone, check the time, check their text when they really should be doing something else. This one's really interesting. One study shows that student users of social media have an average GPA of 3.06, while non-users have a GPA of 3.82. That's about the difference between an 84, 85 student and somebody who gets 93 is 94. I mean, that's almost a 4.0 GPA. It's a big difference. And then this is another interesting fact. When I loaded up on a new post or tweet, it takes about 20 or 25 minutes to return to your original task, and 30% of the time it takes 2 hours. I think we can all atone for this. I mean, I know sometimes I'll get a text, I'll be studying, get a text, look at that, and then I'll check my Twitter, Instagram, whatever, and then I'll get back to what I was doing. Reduce your dependence on likes. I think this is the most interesting thing I found when researching is self-esteem is being lowered by polls we call likes. I never thought of likes as polls. Some people post a picture, have 170 likes and on Instagram, 2 minutes, 5 minutes. Other people posted 3 hours later, still have 10 likes. I mean, I didn't like to think of it before as this is how much people like you, this is how much people like what you're doing, but a lot of people are seeing it this way. Being overly concerned with your profile leads to identity distress because it's your highlight reel. You're showing everybody what's going on in your life that you're liking, like you're loving it, you're on the beach, you're having fun, but nobody sees those lows. You're just showing everybody, you know, you're happy and what you're doing. And adolescents just aren't getting enough practice relating face-to-face. A lot of kids are having trouble talking, can't have conversations. I mean, we talked about eye contact, we're having trouble with that as well. And then this is more also for us. I mean, we're all gonna be getting jobs in a few years and graduating. So creating public and private profiles. Try to avoid anything unprofessional on your social media, at the bar, at a party, anywhere. You don't wanna be posting that in case a future employer looks at it. In my job, I'm really close with the hiring manager, and the first thing he looks at is someone's Facebook. He wants to see what they're posting, wanna make sure they're not doing anything that'll make the company look bad. Then we have top 10 tweets to get you fired. This is interesting too. I know a lot of people like to rant on Twitter. So this is from 2009, and the number one tweet was, "Wow, dot, 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 my job sucks worse than the economy." And this was obviously right during the housing bubble. And then any post that you make public can be seen by anyone. For us, I know a lot of people have Finstas. If you want to post those pictures of you at the Dells, put it on a Finsta, not on your regular Instagram. Now Connor's going to talk to you more about social media.
So what is social media? It's any website that has the ability to give the user access to social interaction is considered social media. Most people think of it as just popular websites such as Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, but it's actually more than that. So Club Penguin, I'm sure most or some people might have had it in here. It's done now, but it gives you chat options, add friends, collect items, build structures, and communicate using a virtual character. It's directed towards children 6 to 14 years of age, so it's starting younger children to use social media. League of Legends is intended for an older audience, but it's the same idea as Club Penguin. You can make friends, create a friends list, form teams, and battle opponents from countries across the globe. And then we talked about this in class a lot, the importance of face-to-face communication. As we discussed, 55% of communication is body language. 38% is tone of voice, and 7% is the actual words spoken. So it's just affecting the younger age groups like a lot more than usual, and a lot can't. They have issues with interviews and such as that to get a job.
And I did nonverbal and social cues, and such as the video we watched like about Jen Hargrave. And such as Connor said, 55% of communication is in fact nonverbal, and only 7% of communication comes from the words we say. Facial expressions and like head movement, such as like nodding, and just like shows that you're listening to what the person is saying, and you're like taking into consideration and paying attention. Gestures such as like hand movement, like using your hands when you talk, and not standing with your hands like this, because you show yourself as coming off like negative and that you have a shield across, and you should just, if you're gonna do that, put your hands in the coaching position. And eye contact, only 80% of the time you're supposed to actually like look exactly into the person's eyes you're talking to, and 20% of the time you're supposed to be looking around for the next thought and next thing you're going to say. Tone of your voice can actually also make a difference, and this only works, the tone of your voice is important 38% of the time. And body movements, such as, like I said, using your hands when you talk, and posture is also important because you want to stand up straight and look presentable, and you want to be confident in what you're saying to your employer. And cyberbullying is also an issue in social media, repetitive action. If you're getting bullied and harassed online more than one time, and this is when it's considered repetitive action. And it cyberbullying causes spreading rumors. Social media can increase how fast these rumors spread, like negative things said about people. And sharing inappropriate information and photographs and videos, again, social media causes things to spread really fast, so if you want to get rid of things that aren't untrue or untrue rumors or inappropriate photos you don't want like employers to see, you might want to either like flag it so it gets deleted, or like maybe like email a person and tell them you want them to delete the photo. And here we have a quote, "Social media screening is one way to enhance the background check to determine whether a candidate should be hired or not." So you should always make sure like your social media is all cleaned up, so anything you wouldn't want someone to see or that could prevent you from getting hired isn't on your profile, such as inappropriate photos or like inappropriate comments that you wouldn't want others to see. And here we did an interview with the CEO of nVent and asked him what he would look for in posts. And he looked for business relationships, recommendations, personal relationships, the posting and content of the posting, the groups that the people belong to, their hobbies and the clubs, and the interests the people had and the strange habits they had. And now I'm going to give it to Dan, and he's going to go more in depth about social media and how you might want to clean it up.
Okay, so you have your jobs and your social media stats, and those statistics basically say that 70% of U.S. business managers say they decided not to hire someone based upon something they found out about them online, which really just ties into you want to be careful on social media. 22% of employers have fired someone for using the internet for a non-work-related activity. 11% have fired an employee for something they posted on social media, and 1 in 10 young job seekers aged 16 to 34 have been rejected by an employer due to content of their social media. Next we have why employers look at social media. They do it to look beyond one's resume. It's really good to get a feel for who somebody is as a person. If you're going to be working with somebody, you kind of want to know what type of person they are. Are they somebody that is going to be compatible with the rest of the crew or not? Pictures of underage drinking, complaints about past jobs or anything of the sort. It's not that you shouldn't have fun, but if you're out having fun, you know, take that infamous red Solo cup picture down at Dell's. Maybe it's full of Gatorade, maybe you get your electrolytes. But to a potential employer, they might look at it as something that's not. And you never want to give off that you're doing something that you shouldn't be doing. Being completely off the radar and having no social media at all will also affect your opportunity to get a job because it adds nothing to your resume. As I said previously, it doesn't add that personal feel. To fix this, one can clean up their social media page by deleting pictures that they would not want an employer to see, and by posting things that present the academic side of yourself, such as posting things you have interest in, the work you're hoping to pursue. The old saying goes, you know, if you wouldn't want your grandparents to see it, don't post it. Filter the content you add to your online presence. Like I said, if one of your friends did take a picture of you down at Dell's with your red Solo cup, having a good time, whatever you're doing, drinking Gatorade, you know, remove that tag, because you don't want that to stick around forever. They will find it. Once it's on the internet, it's there. Delete posts that contain foul language. Back in middle school, I'm sure with all the rage, you were the coolest kid in town, you know, throwing cuss words over here and over there. But now that you've kind of matured, now that you're an adult, you kind of want to get rid of that stuff. It comes across as very unprofessional. Tools like Google's Me on the Web and Canary can be used to build personal brand as well as filter content on social platforms. And then there's adult supervision online. You can always discuss your online appearance with somebody who uses social media as a tool. So say your mother or your father has a friend that owns and operates their own business. You could sit down and talk with them and have them review your social media. Ask them what you could change, how you could come across as a better potential employee. 27% of admissions officers surveyed said they Google prospective students. Parents can also set up a very good example of proper computer use by limiting time in the household from a very young age. They can also set technology-free times and have, you know, just good family time. Thank you for your time, and if anybody has any questions, we'd love to hear them.
How would you go about limiting social media for, like, children in a household?
So to limit social media for children in a household...
Like, realistically.
It's all about being strict. You're the adult, they're the child. No social media means no social media. You take it away, lock it up, you know, even if it's only for a few hours a day, it will allow them to, you know, really experience the real world. I mean, as we said,